Hello, and welcome to An Intelligent Look at Terrorism, a podcast from Borealis Threat and Risk Consulting in Ottawa, Canada. I'm your host, Phil Gurski, president of Borealis. And we are still in the COVID-19 crisis, but there are lots of things to talk about besides COVID. So I had a note from somebody the other day who actually thanked me for posting stuff on terrorism because it took their mind off of COVID. I never would have thought that terrorism would be seen as a good thing anytime soon. But anyhow, on today's podcast, I'm really thrilled to have on the line with me a good friend of mine, Lorne Dawson, who is a professor at the University of Waterloo in religious studies. And Lorne and I have known each other for quite some time and have worked together. And Lorne, welcome to the podcast.
I'm pleased to be here, Phil.
So, you know, we met, I'm thinking probably about a decade ago or so. You were doing a seminar, I believe, in Toronto, and I was at the same seminar on radicalization. But the first question I have for you is, you're a specialist in new religious movements, or as the rest of us call them, cults. How did you end up going from there to specializing or thinking or writing and publishing about radicalization?
Yeah, there's a long story and a short story. I'll sort of give a medium version of it. I mean, I had been working on for about 20 years on new religious movements. And of course, a lot of that was why essentially fairly ordinary, normal, quite intelligent, often university educated people would join these very unusual groups and groups that sometimes were quite deviant in a kind of conventional sense in their practices. And so I spent a lot of time looking at, you know, conversion processes and interviewing people and things of that nature. Then one of the more controversial issues, of course, is whether they did this sort of out of complete sort of free will and agency or there was some kind of coercion involved. Mm. And then the most extreme version of this was when some of these groups, like the People's Temple or the Solar Temple or Aum Shinrikyo, engaged in acts of violence and really acts of almost terrorism in the case of Aum Shinrikyo.
Absolutely. The sarin attacks in the Tokyo Metro back in 95, that was could have been catastrophic.
That's right. Could have been go down in history as one of the most horrific terrorist attacks ever. It was very bad as it was, but you're right, they bungled it. So luckily, not as many people died as could have happened. So as a group of about a dozen scholars in the world looking at why they became violent in detail. And so really just my research on various aspects of that happened to catch the attention of people in government. I got asked to come up to Ottawa and give a few talks. Those talks obviously seemed to resonate. And so the next thing I knew, I was being asked to come to CSIS and RCMP and other places and talk. And I realized I better start figuring out more carefully the relationship between this phenomenon I knew and the terrorism that they wanted me to apply it to. And when I started to look at it, it was quite obvious that my hunches or intuitions that there was, you know, good connections or strong connections were pretty accurate. So that very first publication I ever did as a terrorism scholar, so to speak, comparing the study of new religious movements and the process of terrorist radicalization was back in 2010.
So I remember back in those days, and I remember I certainly came across some opposition, I believe you did as well, about people who were really antsy and nervous, and in some cases quite critical of the link between religion per se and radicalization. A lot of people, and let's call it what it is, a lot of Muslims in Canada were adamant this had nothing to do with Islam. This had nothing to do with the religion. These were loser people. They were mentally ill people. They were just people born on the wrong side of the tracks who made wrong choices. And it had nothing to do with the actual faith of Islam. I certainly push back against that, and I still push back against that. How did you sort of handle that challenge back then when you took your work and you're, as you said, you're moving from sort of the new religious movements per se into the radicalization frame? How is it that you were able to translate that experience into one looking at radicalization?
Well, I always am careful to make a distinction that and this is a very complex issue with multiple layers to it. So maybe we'll start with talking about this, but then there's other aspects of it that we will probably branch out from this. So just going with what you initially brought up, I'm always careful to stress that, you know, no one religious tradition particularly has any overwhelmingly stronger connection to promoting violent behavior. It's a pretty much universal aspect of religious traditions. Including if you're in Canada, which is a predominantly a Christian nation or was in the past, Christianity has a pretty horrific track record in this regard as well. Now,
Exactly.
normally, none of these religions promote violence, especially the kind of indiscriminate violence that is associated with terrorism and so-called religious terrorism, per se. But of course, in the way they actually live and breathe and operate in society, the way in which they exercise power in society, over the centuries, of course, they have become embroiled in promoting and legitimizing various acts of violence. So it's not particularly about, one religion. It's something about a tendency for all religious traditions under certain conditions to move into this kind of behavior. Now, I'm not then globally condemning religion. The thing is to figure out what are those conditions that cause certain kinds of individuals, certain groups at certain times within these religions to see violence as a way of promoting their worldview. So we need to understand the conditions under which religious extremism arises. The new religious movements were sort of an effective way into this because, of course, new religious movements are, by definition, little groups of extreme, exponents of an extreme religious perspective. That's why it's a new religious movement. They're often acting in rebellion against the dominant religious traditions, against the dominant society and societal mores. So they are, already in that status of being an outgroup and of being deviant and of acting against society in many cases. So it's trying to get at how that happens, that mindset. And then more specifically, in the case of new religious movements, almost all the new religious movements that went to violence, into violence, shared certain common features. And the ones that I focused on and were identified by a number of scholars is they all held some kind of apocalyptic millennialist ideology or worldview. They all held some kind of very extreme conceptions that the history was coming to an end, that we were in a crucial period of time that called for unusual and strange actions in the service of gods or some kind of supernatural forces intent for the world. This often was associated with various kinds of very strong and dominant charismatic leadership and styles of charismatic authority, which is a concept that's used very vaguely in society, but actually there's a very solid scholarship trying to, make it a reasonable proposition or an idea that we can use to analyze things. And then thirdly, these were all groups that had undergone what at the time we called the process of social encapsulation. They had become cut off from the rest of the world. The channels of communication to the larger society were severed. They had physically and symbolically and socially separated themselves and become kind of what we now kind of call echo chambers of ideas, right? And so it was just taking those ideas and saying, well, if we look at the dominant form at the time, of course, post 9/11, of religious terrorism we were concerned about, jihadism, that a lot of these same things seem to apply, that the worldview that the jihadist was presenting was definitely a kind of millenarian apocalyptic scenario. That, of course, really came to the fore with ISIS, which was really strongly an apocalyptic group. Clearly, there was a reverence for charismatic figures, charismatic leaders. The whole movement was structured around a handful of charismatic figures. The classic case, of course, being Osama bin Laden. And then it was less studied, but it was clear that young people, when they radicalized, it was because they became cut off from the world and they became trapped in these echo chambers. They became caught up in what we call social encapsulation. Now, I wouldn't use those terms anymore now through study of radicalization. We have other language we use, but the processes are basically the same.
Yeah, you made a lot of good points, and I thank you for doing that. I agree with you 100% on the religion aspect, and we know that all religions are susceptible under the right conditions, as you said. In fact, that my latest book, When Religions Kill, talks a lot about Hindu extremism right now in India, which is nothing new, but it's becoming very dangerous. We have Buddhist extremism in places like Myanmar, and it's I also like the whole millenarian, and you're right. And what really worries me now, and I've been thinking a lot about this. We're speaking as COVID-19 is still keeping us isolated. There are some fringes of society that see COVID as the great leveler. This is a punishment by God. In fact, ISIS calls it a punishment by God. We have far right groups that are calling this some kind of a, you know, this is God's punishment on humanity for a whole host of ills, you know, abortion and same-sex marriage and gay and lesbian or whatever kind of thing. So given all that, sort of all of that as a sort of a backdrop, so you've kind of turned your academic career over the past decade or so. This is an unfair question to ask you to answer in a very short span of time, but if you had to highlight what you've learned about the radicalization to violence process as it obtains or pertains to largely Islamist extremism, but I'd also throw in the far right there as well, what would say are the main things that you think an audience should take away from, you know, what your studies and the studies of other scholars have taught us about what we've learned over the past, I don't know, 15 to 20 years?
Boy, that is a loaded question. As you know, we could sit here for hours and hours and talk about that. So I'll just sort of off the top of my head sort of talk about some of the obvious things. I think whenever I talk, and you know, Phil, that I've actually developed the whole sort of framework, social ecology model of radicalization. So, and in developing that, and you can see how it built out of the new religious movement background, the things I sort of stress all the time is right away to get people to stop sort of othering these people, like the people who are engaged in terrorism, to recognize that if we demonize them and we see them as, you know, markedly different from ourselves, we're never going to understand them. Now, that's a difficult chore because obviously in the end, these are people that are engaged in really extraordinary and for most of us, very repugnant actions. But all the research shows that their background of the people is quite ordinary, right? They are not unusual people. All the research on, they're not particularly susceptible to mental illness. They're not coming from particularly impoverished backgrounds. Now, in some cases they do, right? But we're talking about statistical generalities. So we stress the ordinariness of the people. And then you want to know, well, why are these ordinary people engaged in extraordinary actions? And it almost always starts when they're quite young. And in our research with foreign fighters, we kept finding that it was younger and younger. So that really was in adolescence, 16, 17, 18 years old, that the process begins. It may not mature till the early 20s, but it's really going at a very early stage. And it just seems so logical, as with the case of young people that went off and joined a Hare Krishna or something in the 1970s and 80s, that really what we have going here is an identity struggle, right? It's kids who, for some reason, are not feeling connected to our society. They're feeling alienated from our society. There's a variety of reasons why that's the case. If they're young Muslims, it usually has something to do with their experience as Muslim immigrants in our society. So they're struggling to figure out who they are. They have maybe a few experiences that cause them to feel they'll maybe never fit in. And so they start to tune in on the very thing that seems to be blocking them fitting in, being a Muslim. They start looking for what it means to be a Muslim. They're young, they're naive, they don't have a very good grasp of geopolitics, but they may be driven by a really powerful desire for what Eric Kurlansky calls a quest for significance, you know, to have an impact on the world, to do something, to stand out. Practically just by coincidence, they meet other people with similar feelings. They get connected to sites online where people are promoting the really clean, simple ideology of jihadism. Nice, clear answers. Who's your enemy? Why do you feel the way you are? What are the sources of this problem? What can you do about it? And by the way, the things you can do are heroic and will give you the special status you're seeking in the world. And it's all as according to God's plan, right? It's all religiously justified, so you can feel good about it. Because what I want to stress here is these are not guys out to kill people. They're guys out to do what they think is some kind of great moral quest to save their people, save the world, fulfill God's desire for humankind. The violence comes along with that in the ideology they get into, right? They're slowly convinced that they need to use fire to purge the world or to fulfill God's function in the world. So slowly they get drawn into and socialized to the use of violence in one way or another to achieve their objective. But it only will come about as a result of meeting others, like-minded individuals, and there has to be this very intense social psychological process of bonding with the group and wanting to fight with your colleagues. And that's why, and it's very rare, we talk about lone actor terrorists, but as the evidence, really deep study of lone actor terrorists, has revealed now for the last half dozen years or so, very few of these lone actor terrorists are actually alone. They are networked into all kinds of other people holding similar views and conspiracy theories, et cetera, that they socialize with quite a bit. They're just lone actors because they actually on their own take an action. They don't take an action as a group. So I don't know, there's a kind of a jumble of things there, but it's about ordinariness, identity struggles, bad social conditions, contingencies, bringing them into connection with an ideology which frames everything beautifully and cleanly and simply for them, then meeting like-minded people and the psychological dynamics of that group take over and become the all-important thing in the world.
I couldn't agree with you more. Everything you said, I'm nodding my head as I'm listening to you. I do want to draw a parallel to something you just said, though, and the idea of ordinariness, and you're right. I mean, certainly in my time at CSIS, the guys that we looked at were as ordinary as you and I are in many, many ways. And you also talked about this notion of the lone actor not really being lone. Now, there's one term that I know really gets my goat and has for many years now, and it's this notion of self-radicalization. Do you think that from one of the reasons why the term is still used, in some cases, very senior Canadian officials, including the Minister of Public Safety, do you think there's a sense of comfort that if we see these people as self-radicalized, lone wolves is the other term, we kind of give ourselves solace that, okay, they're not ordinary, they're very, very different, and a normal person wouldn't do that. And if they're truly self-radicalized lone wolves, we can excuse CSIS and the RCMP and everyone else for not seeing them because they never crossed somebody's radar. Because they were by definition solitary in everything, this somehow makes us feel better? Am I making any sense here? Because it just strikes me, with everything you said is true, that even if they act alone, they're still part of greater either personal or online networks or whatever. So why do you think self-radicalization as a concept is still out there, despite the fact that every person I've ever talked to who knows something about it has been trying to shoot it down?
Yeah, no, I think there's real plausibility in that. And I mean, this is part of the problem. Of course, to really verify that, we'd have to do some kind of, like, which I'd love to see done, sociological study of the kind of pressures on public officials dealing with terrorism and agents in CSIS, et cetera. There's probably, you could demonstrate there are institutional forces working on them that bias them to see the world in a certain way. We can intuitively sense that, and I would assume, Phil, from your own experience, could probably anecdotally support that. So we're kind of guessing. But what we see in terrorism studies over and over again, and I just encountered an instance of it, is that there's certain myths that are just really hard to kill because they kind of serve the interests of people, and they're along the lines that you're talking about. So I just completed this very large study. I submitted it just today. It's been taking me months and months, where I looked at 32 studies of foreign fighters, Western foreign fighters that went to Syria and Iraq. And they're the only 32 studies, there probably are others, but they're 32 studies that I could find that really have some data. They're not just talking about policy and speculation or the odd little case study. They really have empirical information in it of all kinds, different kinds. And so it went through for various issues. And one of the issues is about mental health. And the mental health research really shows pretty conclusively that these guys, that terrorists in general really don't have disproportionate levels of mental health issues over against the rest of the population. Are there mentally disordered terrorists? Yes, just like there are mentally disordered teachers and gymnasts or doctors or whatever else, right?
Or University of Waterloo professors.
Yes, that's right. But I encountered a couple of studies. I won't go into details here, right? That published in 2019, where individuals had made this argument that the mental health is really an issue. Their data was not very good, and the data was criticized, and they've come back and dug in again in 2019. And they produce more careful and more elaborate arguments, but ones that when you break it down, it's still no more convincing. They're stretching the data and modifying it, and they're just kind of twisting it all out of place in order to make their case. And so you just sense this is an author, and it's a published work in a leading journal. So obviously it resonated with the editors and it resonated with the reviewers, that they just want to believe this no matter what, even though you have to really revert to some really strange and inadequate data to make the case. And so, you know, on my larger issue, just to make a sort of segue here, this is the same thing I've noticed about religion in general, right? This, on the other side of things, most secular social scientists who are studying terrorism, which is the vast majority of terrorism scholars, they're really reluctant to attribute any significance to religion as a motivation for terrorism, because they don't understand it. And they're kind of worried that if religion is the source of terrorism, that that kind of leaves them out. But also, I think it's because they associate religion with irrationality, and they want terrorism to be, in a strange way, they want terrorism to be a very rational phenomenon so they can understand it like they understand other kinds of political action or other kinds of social action. When it becomes religious, it becomes strange for them. And so as a result, we see really unusual things in the scholarship where they're present in their own papers. Leading scholars whose work I much admire will present quotes from terrorists that are full of religious language and where the terrorists themselves explicitly and quite articulately often explain how religion motivated them. And they will just not comment on it at all, or they'll dismiss it and explain it away. And it's the most extraordinary kind of thing to encounter. So, you know, it's like scholarship in any field. It's we get certain notions in our head that are convenient for us, that serve our way of looking at the world, and it's hard to move away from them.
That's a fascinating point. As I try to remind people, if you think that ISIS, for example, has nothing to do with religion, please find me a single ISIS piece of propaganda in which in the first two lines, in fact, mostly often the titles, there's a Quranic extraction or a hadith saying of the Prophet Muhammad, and the text is imbued with religious imagery. And as you said, quite sophisticated. You raise something which I want to pick up on next, Lorne, and this is something that I know you have had an issue with, I've had an issue with for many years, and that is the field of terrorism studies and the question of data. You know, terrorism studies has made leaps and bounds, especially since 9/11. And the quote that I used to give, which is woefully out of date, was that some 10,000 books have been written on terrorism since 9/11. So we've had this incredible explosion of interest, which is great, from people like yourself, political scientists, historians, religious scholars, right across the academic field. And that's a great thing. But my criticism was also always that a lot of it may be interesting, but it wasn't informed by any data. I get the sense that's getting better. And I know that Bart Swerman at the ICCT in The Hague has made the same point. Do you think scholarship's getting better in the sense that scholars, both seasoned and young, are actually finding real data on which to base some of their statements?
I think it is getting better. And I think I've seen that just over, you know, my 10 years that I've been kind of done a deep dive and transformed myself into a terrorism scholar. You know, I lead an organization, the Canadian Network for Research on Terrorism, Security and Society. And we have many different goals, but one of them, of course, was to help elevate the scholarship in Canada on these topics. And we've noticed, those of us who've been involved with that organization from the beginning, at our last several workshops, we've all kind of, you know, quite surprisingly and pleasingly been able to turn to each other by the end of the workshop, and all are nodding and looking at each other and say, wow, these papers, these presentations are so much better than what we had 5, 6, 7 years ago. And it's mainly because the younger scholars are all bringing to bear very strong conventional social scientific methodologies. They're finding innovative ways of getting data. They're trying to work with data. And as a result, you know, get better results. It is very difficult, though. You know, it's very difficult. It's labor intensive to build up the data because you basically have to go out and grab it from numerous number of sources, court documents, open sources, biographies, and of course, interviews. The thing that's lacking, we have way more interviews now with aspiring terrorists, convicted terrorists, you know, still operative terrorists and, you know, past terrorists than ever before. But it constitutes a tiny fraction of the actual research literature so far, for obvious reasons. It's very, 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 very hard. But I did just publish a paper dealing with aspects of methodological issues around interviewing terrorists just a few months ago. And I was very pleased, you know, that basically I was operating with about a dozen pieces of research that have looked at that issue well. So, yeah, I think we're getting there. But, you know, we really have now just started to set the model of how this can be done. Now is the time when people need to really dig in and even do more courageous work. So in this overview I just did of this research on foreign fighters, it's a kind of good news, bad news story. I mean, I actually say at the end of it, I kind of honestly step aside and take an honest reflection and say, look, real progress has been made. A lot of the ideas that people have been working with for years now about these foreign fighters are being confirmed. So we're not getting new ideas. We're getting good empirical confirmation of things we already thought. That's good. That's progress. But I point out so many methodological limitations and problems and fragmentary aspects of data that in the end, I say it's kind of like a glass half full, glass half empty. And that right now I'm still a bit disappointed then, because not as much was done as could have been done. And we now need to really bear down and take this good beginning and do much more sophisticated cross-natural, carefully developed studies with teams of scholars to really build on where the gaps are in the knowledge. With ISIS gone and with the impetus or pressure off the governments to study this phenomenon, I'm kind of worried that that'll never happen. And so it's kind of one step forward and then we're stalled.
Yeah, for my listeners that maybe not be as familiar with the organization you referred to in Canada, Lorne, so it's TSAS, tsas.org is the website, and it's an excellent forum for, like I said, both seasoned scholars and young scholars to get together and talk about this. You've raised an interesting question about the demise of ISIS, although we all know it hasn't actually gone away. Do you think that a lot of people now are talking about the threat of the far right and neo-Nazi white supremacism, white nationalism? There are some who think that we've been missing the ball on this for decades. I tend to disagree with that. Do you think that we're going to see we can obviously apply the similar methodology you've talked about, the data gathering and the analysis, to any form of terrorism. Are you starting to see some really good data-driven empirical work on the far right as well, though, especially either through TSAS or other networks you're involved in?
And that's just starting to emerge. I mean, there are a few people like Pete Simi and others in the United States that have been at this for a while, right? And have been out there interviewing people on the far right, but it's been pretty peripheral. I agree with you, Phil. I think everyone's been aware of the far right for quite some time. The jihadism, because of the public attention to it and because of the seriousness of the threat posed, occupied a disproportionate amount of time, but I don't think anybody ever forgot about the far right. And everyone is aware there have been far right episodes of violence happening at a pretty consistent pace. There is a differential between jihadism and the far right, though, that I always find hard to articulate to people. And just in vague terms, I think the problem is that the jihadist movement is, in a funny way, globally, a more orchestrated phenomenon. I mean, it is a network of individuals. It's not some hierarchical structure, but there's a greater degree of unanimity, cohesion, dedication to purpose in terms of global jihadism than exists in terms of global far right phenomenon. And so I still think jihadism presents, you know, potentially a more dangerous threat in the sense that it's more likely to pull off some kind of big terrorist action. The far right is growing and swelling and is going to become a real menace in terms of these kinds of actions like we've seen, the mosque shootings in New Zealand, etc. I think we're going to see a lot more of that. We're starting to study that a lot better. So there are a lot of young scholars like Ryan Scrivens, David Hoffman, two Canadian scholars I can just name off the top of my head, who are actually getting out there and interviewing and online interviewing, making the networks, connections. They're becoming very well informed about who is on the far right, who are the leaders, who aren't, who's radicalizing, how are they radicalizing. They're chatting and talking to these people and starting to get the kind of primary data we need. There's a lot of other younger scholars that are really interested in this. So I think that area has learned. We can't do it in the kind of vague, descriptive way in the past. I think scholars dealing with the far right will, from the beginning now, be much more methodologically sound and empirical.
So in other words, the decade or decade and a half or so of scholarship we have around jihadism has informed our ability to look at the far right, which is a good thing, lessons learned. I don't disagree with you, Lorne. Not surprisingly, I am biased, having worked jihadi terrorism at CSIS for 15 years and having written about it exclusively since. I did notice the other day that the PET, which is the Danish Security Service, said that, yeah, we're worried about the far right, but even in Denmark, Islamist extremism, jihadis pose by far the greatest threat to Danish security. I want to end this, Lorne, with a question. You talked about the fact that we brought you into CSIS in the 2010 or 2011. You were the RCMP as well. This is obviously a difficult relationship to manage between, you know, scholars such as yourself and those of us who worked in security intelligence in terms of, you know, clearances and access to information and sensitivity and things like that. In your estimation, in 2020, how is that relationship faring right now? And if you had a magic wand to fix it or to make it better, what would you do?
I don't think, ironically and sadly, I don't think it's changed much. For a while there, if you'd asked me a couple of years ago, I would have said I thought it was progressing or improved. But I think in a funny way, it stalled. I'm not sure why it stalled. people within the security services are increasingly aware and heightenedly aware of the ways in which academic research can improve what they're doing, right? And they're more of the people working in these organizations have advanced degrees themselves and are more comfortable working with academic materials. And academic outreach at CSIS, for example, is for, you know, many years done a very good job of bringing the leading scholars from all over the world to come in for a day or so to talk about what's happening in Iran or what's happening in Syria, et cetera. That's definitely all a change. But we still have the big barrier that Mark Sageman stressed in 2014 and that, you know, has been a bugaboo of a lot of debates. The old business of the services have all the data, but they don't have the time or the expertise to really analyze it properly. And the scholars increasingly really are equipped with really sophisticated methodologies and lots of time and desire, but they can't get a hold of the data. Now, having said that, at least four of the studies on Western foreign fighters in a European context, in the Netherlands and Sweden, there are studies where the government has given the clearances to the scholars and has given them access to the data. And those studies, as a result, are much richer. There was one instance in Italy where this happened as well, but those studies are still very, very rare. So we need to work on that. We need to find some kind of mechanism by which those two worlds can come together. One of my PhD students, who I'll just say in broad tones has a background in your professional world, is now engaged in research that will be on this issue, going in and trying to do a deep dive on, from the side of the security services, the analysts, the investigators, what are the things structurally and otherwise culturally that are preventing them from exploiting the academic world of research more effectively? Why isn't, or how can we mobilize knowledge more effectively? Because I think we're missing a lot on both sides. We have dialogue, but we don't have enough real high level mobilization of knowledge happening. I myself have always wanted to go and be like a scholar in residence at CSIS, and I know that possibility exists. The trouble is life, it's hard to do that, isn't it, right? To just pick up and go spend a year in Ottawa. I don't know what I have to do with my family, right? My dog, I think, is with me.
No, you're, yeah, these are all great points. And I just want to point out that In my experience, one of my favorite security services is the Dutch service, the AIVD. And I was always amazed going back to the mid 2000s, they would publish stuff about what they were seeing on the ground in the Netherlands in an unclassified format, but which reflected their actual investigations. And they've always been leagues and leagues and leagues ahead of what we did at CSIS or anywhere else. And I couldn't agree with you more. And I even argued this when I was at CSIS, we have to do a much better job of not just telling our story, but sharing in an appropriate manner the data that we have so that we can inform Canadians. Because, and there is scope, and you're right, the academic outreach program is a wonderful program, but it doesn't go far enough. And I think that
No.
I would have loved to have had you beside me as a scholar in residence when I was at the service. I have a great deal of respect for the work that you've done. And we, as you mentioned, Lauren, we could go on this topic for days. Unfortunately, I don't think people want to listen to a podcast that goes on for days. But I do want to thank you for taking the time to talk to me and sharing some of your insights. And as I've been telling people for years now, I do see you kind of as the dean of radicalization studies here in Canada. So thanks for taking the time.
I really appreciate it, Phil. It's so easy to talk with you. I know you get this said to you often. It's not a false compliment, right? From someone coming from the background that you are as an analyst, et cetera, even when you were an analyst, you always struck everyone as being one of the most well-informed and knowledgeable analysts. And you know, your own academic proclivities come through. That's a real plus. We need to get this dialogue going on both sides that way. This is a little piece of it. Really enjoyed it.
You know what, Lauren, we should do this again, and I certainly will reach out to you. So thanks again.
Okay. Thanks, Phil.
So that was Intelligent Look at Terrorism. I would really be curious as to what you think of my conversation with Lauren Dawson. So you can reach me on Gmail, borealisrisk@gmail.com. You can also follow me on Twitter at borealissaves. You can reach me on Facebook or on LinkedIn. You can also subscribe to all the content that I put on my website. Go to www.borealisthreatrisk.com, hit the subscribe button, fill in your information, and you'll get all this material free of charge to your inbox on a daily basis. That includes the Today in Terrorism series, podcasts such as this, and other perspectives. I'll talk to you again soon. Until then, stay safe.